Persistent trunk zarteriosus is a cyanotic congenital heart disease, or a cardiac malformation. In cardiac embryology, the truncus arteriosus is the outflow tract of the primitive heart with its four dilatations. We have the sinus venosus, the primitive atrium, the primitive ventricle, the bulbous cordis, and the truncus arteriosus, the structure derived from neural crest cells that's going to give rise to the aorta, the pulmonary trunk, and the semilunar valves. However, for the primitive heart to form the two circulations we have as adults, the pulmonary circulation and the systemic circulation, it needs to be divided between right and left heart, which for the truncus arteriosus means being septated into the aorta and the pulmonary trunk. The pulmonary trunk is supposed to carry deoxygenated blood from the right ventricle to the lungs, whereas the aorta is supposed to carry oxygenated blood from the left ventricle to the systemic circulation. In order to divide the truncus arteriosus into these two structures, neural crest cells migrate to the conotruncal and bulbar ridges of the truncus arteriosus and grow the aortic pulmonary septum, a spiral structure that starts dividing outflow from the left ventricle and the right ventricle around the 8th gestational week. Persistent truncus arteriosus is when the aforementioned structure fails to divide into the pulmonary trunk and the aorta, due to a lack or incomplete formation of the aortico-pulmonary septum. As a consequence, just as in the primitive heart, we get a single large vessel arising from both ventricles that only downwards separates into the aorta and the pulmonary arteries. This is a problem because oxygenated blood from the left ventricle and deoxygenated blood from the right ventricle have to flow through the same vessel, causing them to mix along the trajectory, which leads to a partially oxygenated blood going to both the systemic and pulmonary circulations. Since the blood leaving for the systemic circulation is only partially oxygenated, since it has mixed with the deoxygenated blood coming from the right ventricle, the patient will present some degree of hypoxemia, which is likely to present as cyanosis. Therefore, persistent truncus arteriosus is classified as a cyanotic congenital heart disease. Amongst the cyanotic congenital heart diseases, it's classified as a cyanotic disease which increases pulmonary blood flow. That's because, since both the right ventricle and the larger and stronger left ventricle are pumping blood both into the aorta and the pulmonary trunk, the pulmonary trunk and the pulmonary arteries will be subjected to a pressure higher than normal for the right heart, which will be more compatible with what we would expect from the aortic pressure. Therefore, given the higher pressure in the pulmonary arteries, we will have increased pulmonary blood flow. Since both the aortico-pulmonary septum and the continuous structure inferior to it, the membranous part of the interventricular septum, are of neural crest origin, persistent truncus arteriosus will almost invariably be associated with a ventricular septal defect. If the neural crest cells fail to form the aortico-pulmonary septum to divide the truncus arteriosus, they are unlikely to have been successful in forming the membranous portion of the interventricular septum. Therefore, we will have only the muscular portion. Anatomically, in the presence of truncus arteriosus, the pulmonary arteries can arise either directly from the truncus arteriosus, which is the same structure that will give rise to the aorta, or from the distal pulmonary trunk division of the truncus arteriosus. There is usually a single semilunar valve, called truncal valve, that often includes dysplastic or supranumerary leaflets. Other abnormalities, such as in the coronary arteries, are also common. The condition can happen sporadically or in association with 22q11 deletion syndromes, such as DiGeorge syndrome and velocardiofacial syndrome. Its incidence is thought to be between 6 and 8 per 1,000 live births. mortality is almost 100% by the first year of age without surgical intervention. However, with surgery to reconstruct the right ventricular outflow tract, prognosis is generally good, although it usually entails reoperations as the child grows and needs to have the conduit replaced. The condition can be identified first on obstetric Doppler ultrasound, but usually detected in the early neonatal period. Finally, its differential diagnosis includes mostly other cyanotic congenital heart diseases, such as detransposition of the great arteries and total anomalous pulmonary venous return. If you want to contrast it with these other diseases, make sure to click the links on the screen. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope to see you on the next video. Please bear in mind that this video is only meant to provide an overview of the topic and should not be taken as medical advice. Please consult your physician or the latest guidelines before making any decision. And thank you for sharing your time with me. See you on the next video.